in the yard open house, Tuesday at 9 o'clock, and then they have that, the Denver showcase on Thursday, April 11th, at 6 p.m. And if you're awake this morning, just say amen.
Amen.
And if you know Jesus is alive, just shout, He lives.
Yes.
And if your life, what you see and hear throughout the world today, if you know His return is very soon, brother or sister, and tell them it won't be long.
It won't be long.
It won't be long. No, when Darlene and I pick up Mark from the church, we're commonly asked the why and see all these people exercising, getting in shape. And you know what? When Jesus returns to take us home, I'll be in the best shape ever. How about you? Yes, indeed. Let's begin with hymn number, shall we? Number 12.
Let's stand in as we sing hymn number 12, Joyful, Joyful.
Know where you're going, how can we know the way? Amazing Father, we thank you for the giving of your Son. This weekend we celebrate his death and resurrection on the cross. The brutality that was shown him on that day. But the grace and not hope shown for us when he rose again from the dead. Thank you so much. I lift up all the congregation here and online this morning, and all their cares, and all their words, and Holy Spirit, you are the God of all comfort. Please comfort them, and lead them your way, that the name of Jesus might be glorified. We thank you, Father, for the mission trip just completed, and for the safe return of all those involved. Thank you once again, Father, for all those who raise their hand and look forward to the day when you come to get this home. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Amen.
Okay, well, thanks, everyone.
Mic on. I will move my podium here because I have a little bit of a mission report. I tried to put in a report in about like 7 minutes, a 2 weeks trip, you know, in photographs and in the stories. So total amount of people involved in the trip, Michigan Conference plus some other states have joined us. It was about 170 people and 80 people joining from Indiana Conference. Total 250 people on the trip. Amen? It was a huge crowd. And just a special thanks to the kitchen crew. They had to feed that many people. So anyway, this is when we started. It was Wednesday night when we, some of us, not all of them, not all of us were loading already and on the way to Chicago O'Hare Airport. And this is some of us trying to catch a slip in the airport because it was so deep at night. And this is how we got there in El Salvador. It's a San Salvador airport. It's just, it was a very warm welcome from the school that we were staying at. This is a boarding school, and they welcomed us to their country and to the grounds of ECOS. We unloaded the buses and the luggage, and now everybody had a room where they would stay. And and just like interesting, you know, Angie and Aaron, somebody caught the photograph as they were just starting the mission trip, like, oh, what are we signing up for? But anyway, it was a great one. This is how the meal was cooked. Look at that. I don't recall eating from circumstances like that, and this is how they're preparing their potatoes. And by the way, that meal was awesome. I'm just showing some photographs of food, fresh fruit, nothing like that you would see here in U.S., unfortunately. It tastes differently, so I'm doing some promotion of mission trips, okay? So. Advertising here. Anyway, this is how our building site was looking like. A lot of block inside the building, and I'll show you a picture of our building once we left. It was a lot of work ahead of us, and it was hot weather, 100+ degrees, and we were working outside laying block. And by the way, every day we had a worship service in the beginning of a day, at the end of a day, and we started worship services with prayer. We ended worship services with prayer. And this is Susan out there. She's watching us, unfortunately, online because she had an injury there at the side, and she's not able to attend it. service here in person. Pastor Paige and I there in the picture. By the way, very important feature in every mission trip, okay? Just give you a little bit of information. We started our work, and from the very beginning, the mixer wouldn't work. Like, we're wondering why the mixer of a mortar wouldn't work. And the people that, you know, gave us the fuel, they gave us diesel fuel for gasoline equipment. No wonder it wouldn't work. So finally, we got the right fuel, and we started our mixing our mortar, and off we went, building block. You see, all the construction there is a cement block and the rebar. That's the structure. That's the way we built there, because you cannot build anything with wood, otherwise it would rot. And the bricks at the job are very important, so just you see that. And DOT regulations over there, okay? Just to give you an idea, they live totally different laws over there. This is a sugar cane, overloaded that poor pickup. There's few teams that were working there, the 250 people, they had something to do, and some people were on the job site, they were masonry, they were involved in masonry. Some people were painting, and some people were involved in VBS, some involved in dental and medical work. Some of the people were doing landscape work in that campus of Ecos, that Susan there in the painting crew. You would see her in medical crew later on as well. And this was the first Friday night. It was the dedication of a medical center. That medical center was built in 1998, but for decades it was abandoned, not functioning. And finally, the union, El Salvador Union, was able to get the ownership of that center and rebuild it. And this is when dedication of that center took place, and they just cut the ribbon there. And I would like to share also with you that the medical personnel, local medical personnel, one lady over there, she came and she shared her testimony that she was raised Seventh-day Adventist but no longer attends the church due to some problems that she encountered in life. And she shared with us, as she walked around the campus, she asked, who are these students? Who are these people working all over? And we explained to her this, with this other missionaries, we came from United States to dedicate some time to work for this university, for this school. And she said, is this a kind of a class that youth are signing up for, students are signing up for mission class? And the person said, no, it's just their desire to come and do the work. And she started crying, and she said, you know, they could get an even 10 right now somewhere at the shores, but they have chosen to get the 10 that just looks kind of funny right on their sleeves, burn their necks, and they are doing that for free just to help us out. And she said, well, then this means that not all is lost for our church. That's what she just shared with us. It was a great blessing to hear that testimony. But, yep, that was the dedication of that center. And that next morning was the dedication of Orly Ford University. There is no university in El Salvador, Seventh-day Adventist University, I should say. There are universities, but not Seventh-day Adventist ones. And there's 260,000 members in that country. Just think of that. Michigan has 25,000 members. Okay? Seventh-day Adventist, 260,000 members in El Salvador, and they don't have a university. And by God's grace, the building is there. It's dedicated. We had Pastor Pacheco. He is the union president of El Salvador, he shared a word of God with us. And then this is the president of our union, Lake Union. It's Elder Ken Denslow. He had a dedication prayer for that university. It was a very blessed time. Now, these are some of the students that shared their stories. And these two specific ones that are on the left and on the right from Petty Office. The Petty Office, she's in charge of helping out students to find scholarships from people and go to school there. So that girl, she has lost her father before she was even born. It was due to gang activities. And this boy has lost his father as well due to the gang activities. And they stood up there, shared how God has provided for them to go to school and how they found Jesus in the walls of these buildings. Amen? Okay, well, now we had a day of break, like one of the days we went and saw the beautiful nature in El Salvador, these other waterfalls, and finally I was able to get in the water that was cool, you know, because everything over there, it was very much warm. Even the cold water, you turn it all on and it's still warm. Like, where is the cold water? Nowhere. Only over there I had a chance to do that. And these are some fish in that water. They like to tickle your feet. Now, I know that unfortunately that's where Susan took a fall and she injured her knee on this trip. And also another man, Keith Mattingly, some of you know him, is a former dean of arts and sciences at Andrews University. He came over there to help with the curricula for this local Orly Ford University, and he also took a fall over there at the waterfalls, and he got help at that place. Look at this, okay? Another hidden advertisement, right? It's look at the fruit, the abundance of fruit there, but we knew that we are not allowed to eat it right away. We were supposed to take it to campus, wash it with some chlorine water, and after that only consume it. I was able to lead out in some worship services there. And of those of you that wonder, what is that picture all about? What's so funny about that picture? Okay, look at the reality, all right? Okay, That's how tall this guy is. It's a Chris Bakioki. He's 7 foot tall, you know. My dad and I about 2 feet shorter, you know. So that's, and he actually worked with us on the team. You saw that long rebar and the block was supposed to go over that. He was our crane, you know. He was doing that job and we would pick it up from below. It was a very good teamwork. That's Susan. And by the way, things happen at mission trip. I just would like to say they do. But it's not about the absence of troubles, but how we respond to them. And everybody has responded over and beyond with care for Susan to make sure she has food, that she is able to move around. So praise the Lord for God's care. This is our Masons team over there. We had a picture. That's Aaron on the job site. That's Alex Horvath. I don't know if he's here. Probably he'll be the second service here now. And Alex knew how to relax. You know, that's a hammock over there. Very popular spot at the in meal times. Yeah, there we go. All right, so this is one of our couples, Aaron and Angie. They were both working so hard over there. That's a great blessing. These are the pictures of a dental work that Dr. Peritza was doing there. And by the way, her office is at the exit from Niles, and that's where she went to do the work. This is medical work and Susan helping out in that. And this is the VBS crew that went to the local schools and presented some Bible programs for kids over there. Another unregulated movement around campus. You see the people in the bucket at the back. This was caught on the camera, and they didn't do that anymore, okay? So they got punished for doing that. There was a pool there. We had a chance twice to relax over there, and some of people decided to play soccer at 100-plus degree weather with the local people. Okay, you don't pay me enough to do that, okay? So, and then the second Sabbath that we had a dedication of four different churches, and I and my group were sent to a church that was high up in the mountains. Our trip over there took a long time to get there, and it took a short time to get down, but that's definitely a church that's how it looks. Do you see? Do you see any windows in that? Yeah, you see window opening, right? Well, there's no window, but we dedicated that place and people were so happy they have it placed. You know, my friends, there, I would say the spirit of contentment is fantastic and phenomenal. And we are to praise God over and beyond for the luxury that we have in this country. And, you know, we had a, I had a sermon and a prayer, dedication prayer for that place. And this is our final Sabbath over there. We made a one picture of all the Michigan plus, I would say, missionaries all together. And these Fords still run. You wonder, what is the word Ford? It has nothing to do with automobile industry. It has to do with a missionary that started very hard work in El Salvador. His name is Orly Ford. He was the pioneer of Adventist Seventh-day Adventist work in there. And it was so nice to see his family members, his grandson and great-grandson and granddaughter come to that event of the opening and dedication. If you'd like to know more about him, there's a book that is written about his mission. Okay, so this last night, Sabbath night, it was a talent show, and I can tell those missionaries do have amazing talents. We had a lot of fun there. That's how the building looked when we left. All the outside and inside walls were built and ready for the roof. We laid a lot of block, and we had a lot of people, but that's a great thing when you have a lot of missionaries coming. Of course, they made some good friends. This is a pastor from Stevensville. We were friends before, but trips like that can help you bond together even stronger. And look at this picture, okay? You know, that's I'm in the center, and these two twins, they are the brothers of this guy, pastor from Stevensville, Brett and Brian, very good, wonderful Christians that came to that trip. And the last Sunday before departure, we went to see the church that Clamor Final Church. It's the final call church that we as Niles Westside Church have raised money to sponsor. And I took my group over there to see what they have done. And they didn't even know that we have completed the fundraising and we sent them the money. But they said, we will do what's on us. And they dug the footings by faith without knowing that the money is on the way. Isn't that amazing? So when we came, that's what we saw on the site. The footings are ready. We made a picture with a local team that is so glad to know that the material is on the way and it's coming to help them with that. And that boy that I shared with you that needed a wheelchair, we raised money for that as well. And we gave him the money when we visited them on Sunday. And on Monday, I received a picture that they have gotten him a wheelchair already. So my friends, thank you very much for your generosity. It was the departure day when we were loading and then headed home. You will hear more stories of my mission trip in one of my sermons. I have something to tell, something to share. So we praise God for the safety of this trip, and we thank you so much for your generosity. Let God bless you and all of us in new missions, and we'll see you soon.
Good morning, happy Sabbath. The song I'm going to do for you is out of our hymn book. It is hymn 277. It's titled, For Your Holy Book, We Thank You. It has a little connection to me because growing up, when I was 6 years old, my piano teacher was Dr. Blythe Owen, and she did the music for this hymn. So when this hymnal was published in 85, my dad tells me, hey, your piano teacher did a hymn. And to me, little nine-year-old goes, that's really cool. 39 years later, I'm just going to sing it for you all. Mm-hmm. I'm going to have the lyrics on screen. You may follow along on that. It's mm-hmm. hymn 277 if you would like to watch, mm-hmm. follow the music as well. Mm-hmm.
your strong love and tender care for your people everywhere. For your holy book we thank you, and for those who do day, let the people of all nations reading it and following there know your love and tender care for your people everywhere. For your holy book we thank you, may its message be our guide. Understand the wisdom of the laws it will provide, and your love and tender care for your people everywhere. For your holy book we thank you, may its message in our hearts lead us now to see in Jesus all the grace your words impart, all your love and tender care for your people everywhere.
Amen. Thank you so much, Jean-Paul, for the special music. I praise God that this weekend the world will be reminded of a great sacrifice that Jesus Christ have done for all of us by saving us on the cross of Calvary. And I praise God that our team was here to decorate and remind us of that. And we will come back to that topic of Christ's sacrifice once again in the message that I have. And also I'd like to have a little reminder that at 6 o'clock today at the PMC Church, there is going to be an Easter play done by Andrews University, and my daughter Anna is part of that. So just, I'm quite biased, you know, in this advertisement. Anyway, in his book, Shields of Brass, Roy Angel gives an illustration of God's love, of what that love can do in the life of a despicable human being. Miss Sadie lived at the edge of town and was kind of deprived from a communion of people, community of people. She was kind of hated by all the community. That had to do with her ugly character. Has nothing to do about the physical appearance. It's all about character. And two ladies from a local community decided to give her an invitation when there was a revival. It was a revival. It was a very great revival. And these ladies decided to invite her. And she laughed at them, claiming that if God did save her, they wouldn't accept her in the church anyway. But these ladies, they came back and invited her anyway. And she also sent them away like she did before. And she said, well, I don't even think that that's a way to go for my life. And they finally came for the third time. And at this time, Miss Sadie promised that she would come into a revival meeting if she could sit outside of a tent in the darkness so that nobody could see her. And their agreement was reached, and you know, for five straight nights, Miss Seti sat at the dark as the preacher proclaimed the gospel. And the two ladies joined her outside in the darkness, outside of that tent. And the sixth night, Miss Seti moved to the back row in the tent. And then when there was an invitation for an altar call to accept Jesus, she walked straight to the altar to accept Jesus Christ as Savior. And guess what? On next service, she showed up at the church. And of course, there was a hush in the congregation because, oh, Miss Seti, everybody knew her. She was not the best character known in town. And they were just not quite accepting the idea of her coming into the church building. But then, amazing thing has happened. One of her choir members, a 19-year-old girl, came straight forward to give her a wonderful hug and kiss her and welcome her with her to the front row. And this is when the members learned about the acceptance. They are quite ashamed of their unforgiveness and inacceptance. Now, it was a great emotion in the church. It was a great revival, great service. And Miss Seti never missed a single worship service ever since. Amen? That's what God can do in a life with of a despicable human being. And by the way, when her funeral was there, it drew a great number of people for that funeral. Humans don't like to work with the prostitutes, with the ugly, despicable people, but God does. He chooses many such people to join His kingdom and become useful in His ministry. He judges their sin, but He changes their lives. He also challenges us to love such people as much as Hosea loved his wife Gomer, that was so many times unfaithful to him. And that's why the title for today is Loving the Ugliest. Hosea was the son of Beeri, who is an otherwise unknown. We don't know who his father was. Hosea was apparently from a northern kingdom, the nation to which he preached, and his name means salvation. Hosea's marriage to Gomer and the naming of his three children on the basis of their symbolic narratives in chapter 1 through 3 is a prophet basically is sharing God's heartbreak over the Israel's history. The book can be dated by the southern kings of Uzai, Jotham, Ahaz, and Hezekiah, a possible range of 793 till 686 BC. So one northern kingdom, Jeroboam, this is when Hosea started his ministry. Jeroboam the second, by the way, was the top ruler for the northern kingdom. He did amazing things for his kingdom. He was a great king for his kingdom. However, once he died, the following kings did not succeed on the throne. Only 6 months after reigning, after Jeroboam II, his successor got killed, and so it happened with all the rest of the kings. They got killed. They got they would die in the process. But none of them would be looking for the presence of God in northern kingdom of Israel. People, the nation, continued in their sins, worshiping Baals, worshiping other deities, and that would break the heart of God, and prophet after prophet would come to them and would call, make a call to the nation, please come back and worship God. Now, Hosea is a rather small book in the Old Testament, and you would ask, why did pastor assign entire week to reading this of this just a small book? My friends, there's a great message in this book, and it's not an easy one. However, God has sent us a prophet like Hosea to remind us how much He loves us. Every time I preach on Hosea, I ask audience a question. A question is simple. Who do you think is the strongest person in the Bible? Who is the strongest person that you meet in the Old Testament? And a lot of answers come my way, especially from kids. Well, maybe Samson, maybe David, because he faced Goliath. Maybe Moses, he led such a such a nation to delivery from Egypt, right? And maybe Elijah, he was able to stand before the crowd and just have a testimony for his God. But my friends, I do not know a person stronger than Hosea in the Old Testament. Stronger than Hosea in the Bible, I only know the person of Jesus Christ. Why? Why do I say that? My friends, all of the heroes of the Bible that I just shared with you, David, Moses, and Samson and Elijah, they were, as the Bible heroes, standing firm for what they believed was right. However, Hosea was able to love the unlovable, to embrace something that we cannot understand how you even can do that. That's why I do not know anyone stronger than he was. Hosea was able to forgive and live with someone who destroyed his trust with unfaithfulness and adultery. Hosea was given a command from God to marry an adulterous woman, and we don't know whether she was already in that state when he married her, or that happened while their marriage was going on and she was unfaithful to him as they got married. How would you love someone that lives with you as a your husband or wife, and then only waiting for a moment to get away and commit adultery? How can you love someone like that? I do not understand, and I do not know. And God speaks as the prosecuting attorney in this book, and he is inviting Hosea to be somebody that is invited as a judge as well. Look what my nation has done to me. I have veiled them with my care, with my love, and the only thing I asked them is their faithfulness, and that's exactly what they did not give me. They have turned their backs on me. They have turned around their backs and worshipped other idols, and they committed a spiritual adultery with me. By the way, in those days, the marriage could be ended, and unfaithfulness was a valid source for the end of marriage, and he could only say, she's not my wife, and she could say, I'm not, and he could say also, I am not her husband, and this was legal enough to announce a divorce. Unfaithfulness is just the cause for the divorce on both on human and divine levels, but know that this passage emphasizes the relationship of God and his people. It does not justify the breaking of a relationship on a human plane. The Hebrew text gives the purpose of a children's testimony. Even the names of a children, of their children, was supposed to bring that woman back. Gomer was supposed to understand that her behavior is not right with God and to her family, and she is supposed to return. And now God's lawsuit is not of an angry husband that intends destroying the reputation of his unfaithful wife, but in the opposite, God is trying to redeem the marriage, to forgive the sin, but stop the sinful behavior. Do you understand what God is trying to do with a nation of Israel? Do you understand what God is trying to do with us when we go ahead and sin and are not faithful to Him? You know, people say that there's a great difference in wounds as people receive and then get admitted to emergency room. And some are the gunshots and somebody is being stabbed by the knife and they get admitted right away to emergency room. They get the treatment right away. And there's a great chance if, let's say, your arm is injured, you get treatment right away and sent home, you'll be probably good because you get the treatment that you needed right away. But some people get, let's say, even insignificant wound and wait till it just gets inflamed, infected, and only then they come and get admitted to emergency room. And sometimes it's way too late. They might end up losing their arm, their leg, if it's taken way too long because the wound has become infectious. My friends, the sin of adultery is such a wound. it just spreads around all the life dimensions and poisons the life of a family. And God is reasoning with us, and He's asking us, could you understand how much pain you inflict on yourselves when you choose somebody else but me as your God? And it's just as painful when someone in your family is not faithful to you. You know, today the sin of adultery is being promoted to unbelievable scale, and we have reached and surpassed the sins of Sodom and Gomorrah. Do you agree with that? Absolutely. And just the fact that God did not punish our society for that, yet people are taking for granted, and they think, okay, that's a permissiveness then to go ahead and continue on with the sinful behavior. David Yount in 2004, that's two decades from today, he has published an interesting article, The Cost of Adultery. And by the way, he is telling over there that in America's media, adultery is no longer a crime, and it's no longer a crime, by the way, in half of the states, and in the others, adultery is seldom, if ever, prosecuted. And, the fact, the simple fact that he brought in 2004, the numbers have increased since that due to inflation, that an average person that commits adultery, let's say an average man that commits adultery, within 4 month period wastes into that relationship $26,000 on average, right? Just take this money and into the dumpster. And that's an average, my friends. Just a half of annual income within 4 months. And then everything comes to the surface sooner or later. Then he ends up in divorce. And only 5% of the people that have committed adultery, they end up marrying the person they sinned with. And that's what he states. It's not a good investment at all. Oh, we know that. God told us. From the Word of God, starting with the Old Testament, this is not a good way to go with life. And remember that in those days, Hosea could solve that problem pretty easily. He could bring his wife before the congregation and they could stone her. He had all legal rights to do that. Do you think he could do that? Did he do that? He did not. He could divorce her. Did he do that? He did not. He did not deprive of her rights. In the opposite, he kept buying her back and restoring her time after time. Why? Why would he do that? Because he knew the very principle that Jesus spoke in the Sermon on the Mount in chapter 7 of the book of the Gospel of Matthew, verses 3-5, where Jesus says, first remove the plank from your own eye, and then you will see clearly how to remove the speck from your brother's eye. I will come back to that statement later in case you wonder, why did I bring that up? Okay, let's just go and study this situation. Anytime when we do not choose God in the morning as our God, Master, and Savior, anytime when we do not invite Him in our lives, in the lives of our family, we do commit spiritual adultery. We do. It might not look like, from outside, we might look as a good church members, but my friends, if we do not invite God in our lives, every morning we invite somebody else. And that's what God is saying, that, we are worshiping that we choose. And yet we are not, and that's why Hosea knew that his sins before God are far greater than the sins of his wife against him. And that's why he kept on loving her and kept her buying her back. God of heaven looks at us and sees how we cheat on Him, and His heart is broken. But God found a way to wake us up today and gave us the book of Hosea to teach us how to forgive those that are hard to forgive. Reading Hosea, by the way, is not an easy task for me. Sometimes I read it and I almost feel like I want to vomit because of all of the unfaithfulness that was going on. And this prophet of God was supposed to make right with his wife again and again. But I cannot believe a man would be would keep forgiving and loving someone that is so unfaithful. But God, with the help of Hosea, gives us a clue how much he loves us. He keeps receiving us and embracing us into his arms anytime we commit spiritual adultery and follow other gods. You know, when I was in undergrad, I heard a story that was told to us by a pastor. And the pastor shared with us how devastating is the sin of adultery. And he said that a couple, they were not married yet, they had just engaged. He had to go and do his mandatory military service for 2 years back in USSR. It was mandatory. It's still mandatory back in my country. And before... When he came back, he found out that his fiancée was not faithful to him and she was pregnant, and now he didn't know what to do with that. And he went and saw his pastor and he asked him, "Pastor, what should I do?" And they had a long conversation, and this is what pastor told him: "Listen, do you love her?" And he said, "Absolutely, yes." And he said, "Well, the only answer to you is to forgive. But forgive in such a way that you will never, ever remind her of what has happened before. Can you do that?" It was a long pause before he gave an answer. But then he said, "Yes, I think I can do that." And then he married that girl. And he was raising that child from another man. And they had their own children. And everybody in that village knew them as the most loving each other couple in the village. My friends, question for you. Do you think it was easy for him to forgive? No, but it takes courage, strength to forgive. And that's why I don't know any stronger person in the Old Testament than Hosea. You may say, "Pastor, we are ready to forgive, but what if the people we forgive don't even ask for forgiveness? What if the people that we forgive do not stop their sinful behavior?" My friends, it's not up to us to decide for others what to do. God is inviting you to forgive what it comes to you, and let the other people deal with your right choices. They can respond to that and repent, but they also can harden their heart, and God never forces anyone to take this side or another. He is advising and he is praying us to accept the righteousness of God and the law of God as our guidance. You know, we do have most courageous, most loving, and strongest God, because day after day he keeps forgiving us, the ugliest. And when I say loving us, the ugliest, I do not say anything about the physical appearance. It all has to do with our character marred by sin. In the universe, we are the only ones that have chosen sin. And God loves us time after time, keeps forgiving us, and keeps working with us no matter what. You know, when Jesus came into this world, he was witnessing about the love of God to us, fallen humanity. And in many occasions, he would surprise even his own disciples with his actions. And such a story is found in the book of Matthew, chapter 9, that starts with verse 10. And it says, "Now it happened, as Jesus sat at the table in the house, that behold, many tax collectors and sinners came and sat down with him and his disciples. And when the Pharisees saw it, they said to his disciples, 'Why does your teacher eat with tax collectors and sinners?'" When Jesus heard that, he said to them, "Those who are well have no need in a physician, but those who are sick. But go and learn what it means, 'I desire mercy and not sacrifice. For I did not come to call the righteous, but whom? sinners to repentance, tax collectors and sinners, the outcasts of a society in the days of Jesus and the outcasts of a society in our day and age. If you doubt that, you know, what would you think? What would you think if you would see me speaking to one of the people on standing on the streets and selling their bodies? What would your thoughts be? That would not go well, right? And that's exactly what Jesus was doing. He was having a meal with such people. He would go inside of a house and mingle with those people. And by the way, disciples of Christ did not get into that building. They were standing outside together with Pharisees. For Pharisees, it was unpardonable sin to get in and dine with these people. That's why they were outside. And that's exactly where they caught the disciples of Christ, because they also didn't get in. It was too much for them. This is when they would ask, why your teacher eats with such people? And that's when Jesus responds to them and says, by the way, not the whole may need the healing, but the sick, they need the healing. You know, we say that we judge other people by their sin simply because we don't see our own sinfulness. That's why Jesus said to us, don't even try to pull the speck out of a neighbor's eye until you pull the log out of yours. Why did he say that? Because we can't have an ability for some reason to see our own struggle. Do you know why? Because we tend to dislike people that sin different than we do. That's simply truth. We just don't like them. And that's why we keep judging others, forgetting how sinful we are. And Jesus, answering to Pharisees, he knew that principle. That's why he said, those who are well have no need in a physician, but those who are sick. But my brothers and sisters, are we well or are we sinners that need Jesus Christ? We are all sinners that need Jesus Christ. And those that do not see that, they miss the point and they miss the entire concept of Jesus' ministry here on earth. And Jesus sends them and he says, go and learn what this means. And then there's a quote from the Old Testament, I desire mercy, not sacrifice, for I did not come to call a righteous but sinners for repentance. Do you know who Jesus sends us to learn from? The words, I desire mercy and not sacrifice, is a direct quotation from the book of Hosea. He sends us to Hosea, go and learn that I desire mercy. And who but Hosea knew what mercy is all about? Do you understand why that I cannot see any stronger person than Hosea in the Old Testament? Kendria's story. It's a true story that I read in one of the sources that give Christian testimonies. It's Kendria. She says she was raised in a broken family, and from an early age, she knew what abuse was all about, and it didn't help her when she was growing up, because all of the dynamics that she was able to see in her own family have influenced her bad choices, and one after another, she led her life into open sin. But there was a person that she met in her life. It was the one that she went to high school. They were friends at the beginning, and then he knew of all of her whirlpooling down behaviors, yet he decided to marry her and offer her a better life. His name is Michael. He proposed her, and then she thought, well, probably that is going to help me with my situation. She got married, but it didn't solve her sinful behavior. She still would go into affair when she had a chance to. And her husband found out about that, and he was trying to help her out, and he would fight for her. And my friends, at that time, he was not even a believer, neither she was a believer. But yet he decided in his heart he's going to fight for his family. And then finally, they were able to get hold of some help. A hairstylist offered her to go to church and see maybe Jesus can do something about her situation. And both, her husband and Kendria, they went to that church service. And at the church, God has made a miracle in Michael's life. And he met Jesus as his Savior. And Kendria, she said, I was always open to hear about God, but I was not ready to give my heart to Jesus. And very soon, she slipped back into the old behavior, and there was another affair, another heartbreak, another conversation with the husband. And the husband said, I cannot live with this. You either choose me and live as a family with me, or we are no longer together. And this is when she decided to quit her job. That's where the source of her unfaithfulness was coming. And then she spent two miserable, dark weeks. But after those 2 weeks, she finally has given it all to Jesus Christ. She gave her heart to Jesus, and they've started a new life. And by the way, that's what she gives as a testimony. I was so proud that in one night she had a dream, and in the dream she was standing next with Jesus, and she was so proud to be his daughter. And God says, you are now set free. Welcome home. That is the picture I will never, ever forget. That's what she says. And they live as a family ever since. My friends, was that easy to forgive? No. My friends, but that's what God does with us every single day. Don't you appreciate the love of our God? That's the God we worship. Loving the ugliest is the hardest, and it has nothing to do, ugly has nothing to do with the physical. It's all about character marred by sin. But Jesus loves us anyway, and why don't we do the same when people sin against us? In his book, Shells of Brass, Roy Angel gives a story about a city, the most despicable human being in that township that nobody wanted to mingle with. But after a consecutive steps of reaching out to that lost individual, she decided to come and attend the meetings outside the tent, sitting somewhere in the darkness. And then she moved into the back pew, and then she moved and responded to the altar call. And then she gave her heart to Jesus. And when she died, it was the most attended funeral in town, because that's the power of God to transform the human fallen being. My friends, we serve an amazing God. Let's never forget that He has paid for our salvation. All the world will celebrate His victory over death on the cross. But my friends, is He a victorious God in your heart? Does He have victory in your heart? Does He have your heart in its entirety? That's what you can answer in prayer. Amen.
Let's stand as we sing our closing hymn, Balm of Gilead.
Thank you. you cannot preach like Peter, if you cannot pray like Paul, you can tell the love of Jesus and say he died for all. There is a bond in Gilead to make the wounded whole. There is a bond in Gilead to seal the sin sick soul.
Let's bow our heads for prayer. Dear Jesus, we are so grateful that you came into this world and paid on the cross for our salvation with your own life. And Lord, we praise you. Not only for that, we praise you that you are no longer in the grave. You raised from the dead to promise us that one day soon you will come back to take us home. Please forgive us. Forgive us when we portray ourselves more righteous than other people and forget how sinful we are before you. Help us to come to the foot of the cross every day and never forget what you have done for us. Amen.